system to let me in. So we're just going to try to walk right through the front door. And that's exactly what I did. So I stepped from the car, walked across the parking lot, walked across the street, and I timed it, you know, with a group of employees. So I get my cell phone out and I pretend like I'm talking on the phone as I approach the door. And they're not paying me any attention. You know, here it is just after lunch, and they're heading back in, not noticing the big ugly guy pacing on the cell phone just steps from the door. And when one guy walks up, punches his code, holds it open, and lets the group in. So I followed right behind. Now, once I was inside, I had no clue where to go. I'd never been in this building before, but I kept on my cell phone and pretended like I knew exactly where I was going. And as I walked, I was, you know, kind of checking around, casing the joint, so to speak, and I noticed that the receptionist, dead in the middle of the lobby, she saw me. She knew something was wrong, because when we made eye contact for that split second, her eyebrow cocked a little bit, and I could tell that she wanted to say something. But the lady was so sweet to not interrupt my seemingly so important phone conversation. She let me go right on by, and before I knew it, I was, you know, here we are less than 7 minutes from the time I stepped out of my car, and now I'm already inside in a restricted area, and we've bypassed the gatekeeper and the receptionist. When I wandered around a little further, I basically was able to tailgate anybody into the restricted areas that they had. And again, it was just these little push-button locks, which I thought was really kind of odd. But while I was wandering around, I found my way to their call center, and they were having a potluck for lunch that day. So I sat down and helped myself to some food. I hadn't had a chance to eat yet. There were a few of them that were still taking advantage of the long afternoon, the potluck lunch, and while I was eating, I joined in conversation. I mean, I'm trying to give them a chance to say, hey, you know, something's not right here. Nobody said a thing. In fact, I got caught up. I hadn't even seen Game of Thrones to that point, and I got caught up on some really cool TV and turned me on to the series that I'm kind of addicted to now. So I was able to, again, wander the entire building, and one of the things that I found weird was that in the elevator, everything seemed to be open except for the top floor, which the elevator had a badge reader, RFID badge reader. I'm thinking, that's a really weird place for this. And as I was watching, every once in a while, an empty suit would get into the elevator, and I'd see him reach over and touch the badge reader and head on up. Well, later that day, I found out this was actually the executive level. They had all the executive offices up on the top floor, and that was the only place that seemed to be restricted by any technical controls. So, wandering the building a little bit more that afternoon, I found the stairwell, and it was really weird to me, because as I made it all the way up to the top of the stairwell, that door was not locked, not badged. I was on the executive level, bypassed the elevator, and walked right through the door. Exploring a little more through what was on this executive floor, I found there was an empty office in the corner, and so I just kind of slid my way in to observe, just see what was happening, and nobody bothered me. I sat with the lights on. I just kind of sat in the chair listening, watching. After about an hour, I plugged my laptop in and thought, well, let's see what we can touch. Let's see, what can we see on the internal network from the layer level of access that I'd had to this point. But it was just interesting to me that I was able to sit there for most of the day, unaccosted in this office. When I would get up and walk out, people saw me several times walking out of a dark office. Nobody said a thing. I was able to roam the building for the rest of the day, and by the end of the day, nobody bothered me. So I said, okay, well, we're gonna call this a wash. We're gonna come back tomorrow and see what happens. Well, as I was walking out, I see an empty office, and I thought, well, you know, I've been in for a good part. I should probably call and notify the breach. So as I'm walking past the CEO's office, I see, oh, look, hey, a desk phone. Let's go ahead and I just mashed some buttons until I figured out how to dial an internal extension, at which point I called and I said to my site contact, hey, you've been breached. Oh, and by the way, I'm calling you from an office upstairs. Now, he just kind of chuckled, you know. He laughed and started to sob, and we both kind of wished that we could go for a shot for a minute there. But then we decided we were going to talk a little bit more and see, you know, how long do we want to extend the assessment for? Yes, he wants me to come back tomorrow, but he said, let's take it a step further. I want you to come back and keep coming back until they catch you. Let's see how long it takes for somebody to respond. So I'm going to go you one better. Let's see how long it takes for them to respond, and then let's dissect the response afterwards and see if we can help in, help build on the internal processes. So as with all weeks, Tuesday came. I got there again a little bit early, trying to stalk my prey, and I pulled into a Starbucks just beside the Target. I waited because those of you who know the how it can be in any of the populated places, Worthington, Dublin, you know, dealing with Easton traffic, trying not to be late, everybody's shuffling in pretty hurriedly, and I was able to mix myself in with the flow of traffic and got right in, followed the group in, and I timed my approach again to the building with this young employee who was way too enthralled by what was going on her cell phone screen to realize that there was a big ugly giant traveling behind her. I mean, I was only a few paces. Right, so a few feet behind her, again, trying to make people uncomfortable, followed her right in. Nobody said a thing. Wandered the building for a little bit longer, made my way back up to what I referred to in the deliverable report as my office, was able to wander around and still unaccosted. Nobody bothered me. So I decided now, you know, this was my base for the rest of the time I was here. This office now was going to be mine. So I sat around for a little while. I decided, you know, we're going to really step it up a little bit more. So I left to go have a bite of lunch. And as I was walking out, I made friends with a couple of employees walking down the stairs, and I joined them for lunch. Now, after the meal, I'd made first name basis with some of these people, taken on the personality of Jake, not from State Farm, but Jake from IT, who is much less hideous, let me say. And when I came back from lunch, I was wandering all through the call center, wandering all through the executive level, wandering the entire building, putting hands on hardware, talking to people, you know. I was using the guise of I was cataloging asset tags that I needed to see, you know, make sure that we had all of our equipment where it was supposed to be. Nobody asked. Nobody said a second thing about it. And then I wanted to go a little further and get them, hey, would you mind sending an email for me? Oh, hey, would you mind, here, hit the start button, run the command prompt and type in these commands. No questions asked, didn't bat an eye, I had no ID, didn't ask for a business card, nobody had seen me before, and I still am able now to have not only make modifications myself by putting my malicious USB into these machines, but I could have legitimate employees taking action for me without even asking a question. And I mentioned the little USB thing. We had it set to be able to just pop a command prompt. Again, I wanted to let them know that something was happening, so it auto-played the command prompt and went away. Still no nothing. And then it would pop a shell back to my machine waiting up on the executive level so that I could get a foothold. By the time I got there Wednesday, my friends from lunch the day before recognized me as I was getting out of the lot, and we had a nice conversation as we were walking in. Nobody really seemed to notice that I was a stranger. At least that's what I thought. I was able to walk in and out, spend time in my office, roaming around, you know, walking the entire building. They were doing some construction, which was, you know, after the fact, this was kind of the reason why they said nobody saw me, because I look like a construction worker, apparently, even though I don't know construction workers that dress, you know, like this. But I looked like a construction worker, so nobody bothered me. But that would let me move some materials around. I actually even put some hands on disconnected machines. I could have walked right out with these machines that were going down for decommissioning, and nobody ever knew. I found the data center, which was protected by lock and key. Does anybody in here use lock and key anymore for the data center? No? Well, needless to say, that proved very ineffective against my lockpicks, and even less effective against the trios or duos of employees that would come and go. They'd unlock the door, walk in and out at will, do whatever they needed to do, and then they'd leave again. I could stand around. I stood by the door for about an hour and a half and walked in and out of the data center four times being able to just tailgate somebody in, and nobody said boo. The weird thing about it, though, was that while nobody stopped to question me, nobody asked who I was, where I was going, why I was there, but everybody was so nice. They all said hello when we passed. They'd all smile. See, people they want to help. They want to be happy. They want to be friendly, but they don't want, especially somebody like me. You know, who's going to stop me and say, hey, who are you? Where are you going? Hopefully, you can answer everyone in your organization would. And if you can't, this is why I'm here talking about it today. Because yes, I love breaking into these things. I love being able to test the perimeter, to be able to find weaknesses in physical controls. But what do we do? I mean, if they aren't really being effective, what's the point of them? Anyway, so Wednesday, I get in, wandering around again. Nobody bothers me. I had hands all over the machines. I have pictures of me in the data center, pictures of me at the CEO's office while he's eating his lunch and working. I have pictures of me under security cameras, faces, and nobody bothers. I'm hoping that somebody's going to respond, and I get nothing. So the end of the day, it's about 4 o'clock or so, and people start shuffling out. And as I'm walking out, I get a, hey, so great to see you. I'm Alex. Who are you? So, hey, Alex, I'm Dave. How are you? Nice to meet you. He said, I'm great. I just wanted to know whose team are you on? What are you working on? So, Alex, I'm on my team. Whose team are you on? And he said, oh, well, you know, I'm just curious because we've had a couple of complaints. Some of the females have said that, you know, you've been following them in and made them a little uncomfortable. Now, at least we know somebody's saying something. The question is, A, when did they first say something? And B, how long did it take them to say something to me? Had this been, you know, a worst case scenario, the fallout to this point could have been quite hectic. So me doing the dance that I always do, you know, I told him, I'm just here doing some work for Steve. You know, go talk to Steve and he'll be able to tell you everything that's going on. Well, there is no Steve. But he said, well, let's go get you a badge. I said, no, Steve said I don't need a badge for what I'm here for. You go talk to Steve, and then if you want to go get me a badge, we'll go do that. So he turns around and walks away. I don't know where this guy's going. There is no Steve. Right? Where you go? Who's Steve? Well, as soon as he was out of my line of sight, I made a beeline for the door. See you later. I made my exit, and no badge to be had. I don't know if he ever found Steve, but yeah. Hopefully it wasn't like, where's Waldo, right? So this is my favorite part. On Thursday, we get to come back, right? Oh, I missed the slide. That was supposed to be that one. So my cover at this point, I considered it to be blown, right? I probably could have pushed my luck a little bit more. We probably could have kept the assessment going. I could have played hide and seek from Steve the way I had been from Alex the way I had been the other people as I'd been. I mean, I got an expert at hiding in the bathrooms and all over the place this week. But Thursday came and, you know, we decided it was time to do the outbrief. It was time to, you know, explain everything that we did. It was time to funnel through the not so small stack of findings. So I set the appointment with my contact for just after lunch. And as I walked in, you know, by this time, checking in wasn't even a thing. I just walked right past the receptionist and walked on up, and still, nobody said a thing. You know, and as I'm getting ready to head to the stairwell to go to the executive office, I hear the ding of the elevator, and I hear, hey, Dave. I turn around. Remember, I was Jake from State Farm, but I used Dave a little bit, too, just to kind of see what was what. And it was Alex. Now, I found out Alex was actually the security manager. We're talking for a minute. Great to see you. Thanks for coming back. Where are you going? I said, I got a meeting up on the 4th. You know, I'm going to go talk to the board. Well, here, take the elevator. Slaps his card on, sends me right up. Again, no badge, no ID, not even my real name. Thanks, Alex. So the idea here is, you know, we need to be thinking a little bit differently. We need to be trying to, again, engage the users. We need to realize that you've got controls available, but we're not tapping one of our greatest resources, and that is to hire and build to the corporate culture that we need to propagate. And that's one of people who are as invested in their positions as each of us are in ours. Now, I know this opens up a whole other can of worms in the hiring side, right? About how do we hire somebody that's going to actually do the right thing? How are we going to hire people who want to be good digital citizens? We need to start trying to equate how good behavior doesn't stop at work. Good digital behavior, being a good online citizen, is something that we should be doing every day. On Facebook, in email, on Twitter, and everywhere. We need to be getting people to realize that their actions, their habits, spill over into every walk of their life, especially when we're talking digitally. Because there's so much that we all rely on. I bet there's not a one of us in here right now that doesn't have a smartphone in our pocket, or a tablet, or a laptop, or a combination of the three. But by working to propagate a culture that's getting people who want to buy into doing the right thing really isn't going to be that hard if we can work to change it from the ground up. And that is by teaching our kids, teaching our students. I've got the inaugural Cyber Patriot members for my team is actually here with us today. Being able to see kids who want to do better in their own behavior and possibly go on to build a career out of it, or at very least in whatever walk of life they choose, in whatever work they decide to do, we may get a small fraction of them to think, hey, I remember that I shouldn't set my password to password 123. Or, hey, maybe I should change my password more than once every never. Or, hey, maybe I ought not use the same password for everything. Because we all know that that's still happening. We need to stop thinking that it isn't going to happen to us. If you haven't been breached, if you aren't being breached right now, you will be. Don't we want to use that the asset of our best IDS, the best IPS that we have, our people, and get them thinking about these things a little bit differently so that when that command prompt pops up on the screen that they say, hey, I don't know what you just did there, but it did something different to my machine. Question what's different. Start looking to make the users feel invested. My team's done a lot with user awareness and trying to bring these programs to the corporate culture, trying to build a program from the ground up that takes actual data from your organization and is able to pull that into a program that helps make your users do a little bit better. And it gives us, or you, the organization, the power by which to show metrics that either they're doing better or doing worse, and to build coaching along with those. But it's finding the people who are willing to see the value in making these changes that we need to be looking for. I know it's a lot to ask, but this IBM cost a data breach study kind of shows that it might be an expensive investment, sure, to take time out of productivity, to get your users together and to start talking about why you shouldn't click on the twerking snowman. You know, these things matter, and they just don't think about it, because a lot of times if I'm looking on Facebook and I see a twerking snowman, I want to know why he's so happy and I'm going to click on him. But we have to be fighting these battles every day and making the people realize that, you know, it's just a twerking snowman, and most likely there's something dangerous behind it. And if there's not, then be looking for the anomalies by which, you know, to say, hey, something's different here. All right. So with that, I want to try and keep on the schedule. I was able to burn through that a little bit quicker. So if there's anything that we want to talk, any questions that I can answer, I'd like to take those now. Yeah, Tim.
Physical test.
The question was, what was the attire during day one of the attack? So I went with outfits prepared for everything, and I didn't know what to expect. Because of the nature of the beast, I showed up with a suit and tie. But as the day progressed, about a half hour into it, and I realized everybody was casual, so I was able to change in my vehicle. I try to assimilate to whatever the culture seems to be of the target. So it was jeans and a t-shirt on day one, and then dressed pretty much like this for the days after, because again, I wanted to kind of stand out a little bit to give them, especially once I heard that I look like the construction worker. You know, I didn't want to be jeans and a t-shirt and have somebody really thinking, oh, he's supposed to be here. So it was basically like this after the fact. No, I breached this. I breached the and jeans and a t-shirt. Jeans and a t-shirt, and nobody said a thing. Yeah.
Phil, you've been doing this for a long time.
Yes, a long time. Has the arc of it gotten any better? The question is, has the arc of it gotten any better? I've been doing this for quite a while, both officially and not. No. Unfortunately, overall, it hasn't. You see some organizations are starting to evolve. Most are starting to evolve. But what I find more often than not is we're spending all our money on things. And the blinky boxes just aren't stopping us. Because, I mean, at this point, you know, I was able to walk in and modify machines, walk out with them. So, yeah, no. Sure. No. Do we have documented physical intrusion reporting processes? No. So most of them will have the receptionist or whatnot, right? But they don't have that. Even the logbooks, they expect you to sign in. They want to badge you in or something like that. But those get shredded at the end of the day. They don't even really keep a forensic log of who's coming and going, let alone to be able to keep a log of what that person is doing inside. Another example of this is actually something that I did just fairly recently. A huge campus, right? We're talking, this is critical infrastructure kind of thing, a huge campus. And they're like, you know, we've got gates, we've got guards, we've got cameras, everything. It's great. Well, I get there and we're talking, I mean, a place that's roughly the size of this city block, this campus, right? And they had two cameras, one of which was inside their warehouse, and that was only because they'd had some theft recently, and that's from their own people. So looking around a little bit more, when I went to do a walkthrough of the perimeter, I was floored to see, I mean, we're out in the middle of nowhere, right? One camera protecting this place, no IR, no motion detection, no lighting. I mean, when it goes dark, they're pretty much blind. So no, we don't even have valid physical controls, let alone valid response or detection when it comes to physical stuff. In the back there. Not yet. It's coming, but not yet. The question was, did we do a retest? Nine times out of ten, yes, unless they're too ashamed to ask us to come back. But yes, that will come, and hopefully that'll make it into next year. Anybody else? Up in the cheap seats? No? You know, I'm still trying to figure that out. I have no idea. New glass in the doors, maybe? I mean, a desk for the receptionist? I have no clue what it could have been. It certainly, they didn't spend it on any controls that could keep me out. I'd tell you, but then I'd have to kill you. No, we've got a team. So I try, you know, depending on how badly the bridges are burned by the time we go back, it may well be me. A lot of times, you know, we will send the same just to, again, to give them an opportunity to win. Because the odds are stacked against. How many of you in here are blue team, defense side? Wow. Okay. Not nearly as many as I thought. But the problem is you're fighting the uphill battle. You're drinking from the proverbial fire hose because you've got to be right every day, all day, and I've just got to be right once. So, you know, there's so much growth to be had out there that it does, we want to give a chance for them to realize, hey, we've been through this before. All right. So I'll be around for the rest of the conference. I really appreciate you all coming to see me. I hope you have more questions and more to talk about later, but they took the slides down. If you want to talk any more about this stuff, I'm the Grape Ape, and I'll look to see you around. Thanks.